Thank you. and I'm glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning. Praise God. Some mornings you get up and you just want to give just one of those, woo, just praise God in the morning just to let Him know that you're still alive. Sometimes God wants to hear and know that you're still alive. He puts life in you. He gives breath to you. He just wants to know that you're still living. Praise the Lord. It's good to be here this morning. It's just a glorious day in the Lord. A day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. I hope that everyone's had a blessed week this week in the Lord, and just been filled with life and just in a place of praise with God, just for all His thanksgiving and for all the things that He's done for us this week. But I've been in prayer this week, and I'm a little loud, Brother Pete. I've been in prayer this week, and been praying to God, and been seeking God's face on the things that's going on in the church world today. And how many in here believe that we're in a war?
Amen.
How many believes that we're in a war?
Amen.
Amen. Praise the Lord. A few of you believe it anyway. Hallelujah. But I believe that we're in a war in this today and time that we're in. I believe that we're in a war that that we're facing, that we can't battle with this flesh. We can't go into war with this flesh. We can't go into war with an M16 or a machete or whatever weapon of choice we may choose. We can't go into this war that we're in with those things. We're in a spiritual war right now. I believe that we're in a war right now that, that the devil, he's trying to drive a wedge in the church. I believe the devil's trying to drive a wedge in your home. I believe the devil's trying to drive a wedge between your husband and wife. I believe the devil's trying to drive a wedge between you and your children. There's nothing the devil wants more than to see a church split or to see a marriage fall apart. It gives him glory to see those things happen. I believe that there's a time such as now, though, that we need to anchor down to Jesus. We need to grab a hold to something that's going to hold on and it's everlasting. We need to grab some hold of something. Thing, God, that's willing to rise up in war, Father, in this war that we're in. God, I ask you right now just to anoint your servant and hide me behind your cross. God, let you be seen and not me, Father. Lord, I ask you to bless your people once again. In Jesus' almighty name, amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Matthew in chapter 16, and we're going to read just a few verses of Scripture in Matthew chapter 16. Oh, praise the Lord. The title of this sermon, if I could title it anything, it's going to be The Church Will Live On. The church will live on. And there's three reasons the church will live on. It's because of one, its family, which is the I Am. The great I Am. That's the family. Number two is its foundation that it's built upon, which is Jesus Christ, the chief cornerstone, which is Jesus Christ. The church is not founded upon, it's not founded upon Peter. It was not founded upon the apostles. It was not founded upon John the Baptist. It was founded upon the chief cornerstone, Jesus Christ, amen, the Son of the living God.
Amen.
And number three, because of its faithfulness. The church will stand because of its faithfulness. Because in the test of time, there's one thing that's going to remain, and that's going to be Jesus Christ. That's going to be God the Father. That's going to be the Holy Spirit. Those three things will always remain. And I believe as long as those three things remain, the faithfulness of the church will live on. Because there's always going to be a people that want to strive to serve God. There's always going to be a people that want to feel the presence of God. There's always going to be a people that wants to come into a sanctuary and praise God. We don't live in a country where we have to hide to go to church. Or we have to have underground churches. We're in a place right now that we've got free will to go to church. And some of us don't even get up and go. But what would it be if we had to fight to get to church? What would it be if we had to have somebody stand guard with guns and AK-47s and M-16s? And we had to have big men like Mark and Ed stand at the door. And Marvin, it's just to protect us so we can come in and worship God. Some people have to do that. They have to physically war. But we're in a place that we've got a freedom to serve God. But we're in a spiritual war here. I believe that in a lot of other countries, they're spiritually strong. And they're in a war that they know who they serve. They know who they fight against. They know what battle they're in. And they've hunkered down to Jesus. But as a freedom country, as a country that's gained freedom to worship and praise God as we want, we've learned to a place that we've gotten laxed in our Christianity. We've gotten laxed in our Christianity where we just go when we want to, or we pray whenever we decide we want to pray. If you talk to a lot of missionaries and people overseas, and they constantly are in prayer. They're constantly in a place of war. They're constantly warring in the Spirit because that's how Christians should be. In the book of Matthew in chapter 16 and verse 13, starting here. It says, when Jesus came into the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, saying, who do men say that I, the Son of Man, am? So they said, some say John the Baptist, some Elijah, and others Jeremiah, one of the prophets. Now, I'm going to tell you what. I'm just an old country bumpkin from Mount Airy, North Carolina. Backwoods, don't speak real clear, but I ain't nobody, but boy, if I was ever referenced to being about an Elijah or a Jeremiah or one of the prophets, I would feel good about myself. I would feel good if I was ever referenced to one of them. And it says, he said to them, but who do you say that I am? Who do you say he is, church? Who is Jesus to you? Who is Jesus to you? Is he just someone that we go to church for a couple times a week? Or is he someone we just call upon when we need something? Or is he what you live for? Is he what you live for? Is he the one that gives you breath in your lungs? Is he the one that puts a praise upon your lips? Is he the one that puts a song down in your bones? He says, whom do you say that I am? And Simon Peter answered and said, you are the Christ, the Son of the living God. Hallelujah. The Son of the living God. I'm not here to tell you, church, we don't serve no dead God. We don't serve no dead God. I can feel him in the midnight hour. I can feel him at 6 o'clock in the morning. I can feel him at lunchtime when I'm eating the bologna sandwich. I can feel him whenever I need to feel him because we serve a living God. We don't serve one of these gods that we set up on the mantle and we come in and have to burn incense to him and get our sins sacrificed by a priest. We don't serve a Buddha. We don't serve a statue. We serve the living God.
Amen.
Simon Peter answered and said, "You are Christ, the Son of the living God." Verse 17 says, "And Jesus answered and said to me." I like it when Jesus answers you. I like it when he answers. I like when you get into a place with God, and Sister Patty, you're in a place with God, and you're praying for something, and you're seeking God for something, and you want to answer. And most of us know the answer to what we're asking already. Some of us ask for a brand new car, and you know if you can't afford it, God ain't going to tell you to go buy one. But I believe that I love it when you're in a place of prayer and God just gives you an answer. Amen. When he just comes down and gives you an answer just as I'm speaking to you right now. Amen. Praise God. Ain't that right, Brother Fred?
Amen.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. And Jesus answered and said to him, "Blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not revealed this to you, but my Father who is in heaven. And I also say to you, that you are Peter." Let me tell you right there, let me stop. There's a comma right there. That means it's a pause. All Jesus is saying is he's letting Peter know that he knows who he is. He's not telling him that you're Peter, the rock that the church is built upon. You are Peter, and I know who you are. And that means a lot to me. It may not mean a lot to you, but it means a lot to me because I know Jesus knows my name.
Amen.
I know he knows my name. He's called me by name. He's numbered the hairs on my head. As if you've fallen out. Praise you, Lord. I didn't like that joke, did you? All the people who had never left. And it says, "And I also say to you that you are Peter. And on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell shall not prevail against it." Y'all didn't hear me right there. And on this rock. Now that's the foundation I just spoke upon. That's number. That's the foundation that will always be standing. That's the foundation that's everlasting. That's the foundation that won't shift to the left or to the right. It won't crack and it won't crumble. I've been in houses and had to go in, Brother Marvin, and replace a foundation before because it wasn't built upon something solid. In the old days, they just put rocks up under the house, and the houses begin to sink, and you'd have to go in and jack them up and put a new block under it and dig a foot and put something solid underneath it. But I'm here to tell you, you won't have to remove nothing that Jesus has said in order. You won't have to. He don't need you to rewrite the Word of God. He don't need you to rewrite salvation. He don't need you to rewrite sanctification because he's done wrote it. It's done been laid upon the rock, which is Jesus Christ. The rock is the foundation, which is Jesus Christ, the chief cornerstone. And then it says, he's talking about himself. He said, which is the founder, will build my church. I'm going to let you know right quick, church. This church belongs to God. This church belongs to Jesus Christ. This church belongs to God. I don't care what denomination we are, the Baptist church down the road, the Methodist church down the road, the Freedom Church down in Liberty, it belongs to God. It don't belong to no individual person just because if we've got a name on the deed for the property or the building. It don't belong to us. It belongs to God.
Amen.
Praise you. And it says, "I will build my church." The church is his. He set people in order, stewards and laborers and leadership in order to help run the physical church. But he don't need no help running the spiritual church. If we just sit back and let him drive his train, we'll get where we go. We need to sometimes, it's kind of like the backseat driver. I don't never drive, and I do have license, but I don't never drive. She likes driving because she says I like to look too much. And I'm riding down the road, I'm like Brother Marvin, I'm always looking for something to buy or trade or sell or something. And so I'm riding down the road, and she's like, "I'm driving from now on." Since for 12 years, she drives everywhere we go. And but you know, that's kind of the way we do with Jesus. Is we want to jump in the shotgun seat with him, and I'm going to drive. Let me it's that old song, Jesus Take the Wheel, or I've seen the license plate, Jesus is my co-pilot. I'm here to tell you, he ain't my co-pilot, he's my pilot.
Amen.
He's my pilot. He's flying this plane. I'm just going to ride with it. Praise God.
Amen.
And it says right there, and it says, and build my church, and the gates of Hades shall not prevail against it. And that's the faithfulness of the church. That's the faithfulness right there. That's how the church is going to stand. That's how the church will live on, because Jesus has made a promise right here. Because you can take every word that proceeded out of the mouth of God, you can take it to the bank, it'll not come back void. And I believe when he said, "In the gates of hell shall not prevail," I believe that's a promise, Sister Linda. I believe that's a promise, Sister Brenda. I believe that's a promise that when the gates of hell come, it will not prevail against the church. Now we can tend to let things get drove into the church. We can tend to let a wedge get pulled in between our marriage. We can tend to let a wedge get pulled into something. And most of the time, a lot of us, we only call out to God when we got something wrong. Or we got a problem. Or we're down in our body aching and say, "Oh God, help me." And if you notice, when people get hurt, the first thing they do is, "Oh Lord, oh Lord, oh God." But that's the way the church has become. We've become this church that tries to self-sustain without God, without having the presence of God. I'd hate to know that I go to a church and try to praise without the presence of God. I'd hate to know I go to a place to preach or to pray without the presence of God. I believe that the faithfulness of God saying that the gates of hell will not prevail will cause the church to live on.
Amen.
The church will stand. The church will continue to be.
Amen.
And it says, "And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. And whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. And whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." He said, and it says, "And I will give you the keys." And I want to tell you right now, it says, "I will give you the keys." If you're battling with something in your life, you've got the keys to lock it out.
Amen.
You hold the keys. Gee, this ain't something that Peter said. It ain't something that Paul said. Jesus said, "And I will give you the keys to the kingdom of heaven."
Amen.
I give you the keys, Brother Martin. We shouldn't even be in a place that we're in a spiritual warfare, because we have the keys to lock out the junk. We have the keys to lock the trunk on Satan. We have the keys to lock so the gates of hell will not prevail against us.
Amen.
But so many times that we forget that we have those keys. And it says we have the keys to the heaven and whatever you bind on earth. Now I see people come to the altar. And I'm not going to call no names, and I'm not saying it's anybody in here. But you'll know if you're one of them. People come to the altar, and they get prayed for, and they get prayed for, and they get loosed of stuff. And then the following week, they back up and get prayed for the same thing.
That's right.
That scripture is just as bold and blunt as it can be, and it says, and you can bind whatever you bind on earth is bound in heaven.
That's right.
Amen. Yeah.
Now, some of us tend to bind stuff while we're in church, but most of us are loose at the time we get out the door. We'll bind something that's something somebody that's been talking about us, or we'll bind some kind of spirit that's rising up in her, causing anxiety. And I've got it. I've bound this anxiety, and I don't have to have this anxiety no more. But before we get out the door, we're unlocking it.
Yeah.
How you, Brother Sam?
Doing good. How are you?
Hallelujah. But I believe that a lot of us, we tend to do that. We come up to the a church and we'll get people to pray for us, and you know, we got to bind it. And you know, and I don't see nothing wrong with anybody praying for anybody. I've had people praying for me this week. I've had people. I hope everybody prays for the pastor. But I've had people pray for me this week, you know, multiple times. But you know, and it's not that I don't have the power. It's not that it's nice to have other people pray. But I'm here to tell you that all I've got to do is call upon the name of Jesus myself. All I got to do is call upon Him myself. He says, "Whatever you bind on earth will be bound in heaven. Whatever you loose on earth will be loosed in heaven." I believe there's time we start binding stuff, church. I believe there's time we start binding together and binding stuff out of each other's life, out of each other's home. I believe we need to start praying for each other. We need to start praying for each family. I believe that we need to start loosing the Holy Spirit on each other. place and time so many times that it ain't very proper anymore for us to come up to the altar like it used to be. Now, I can remember as a small child when someone would come up and get saved and in the old holiness, and a lot of you know what I'm talking about, and you get down and you give your life to the Lord and you rise up, and there would be some elder woman or elder man and say, "You got it?" And they'll say, "Yeah." "Well, are you sanctified?" And you're like, "Well, get on back down," and they push you right back down. And then you get up and "You got it?" "Yeah." "Well, are you filled with the Holy Ghost?" And you get right back down, and you didn't get up until you got it.
Amen.
I've seen people lay in the altar for hours until they got it. But we're living in a time that we try to battle against the principalities of darkness without even having the Holy Spirit on our side. And I'm not saying you're less than a Christian because you're not baptized in the Holy Ghost and speaking in tongues. That's not what I'm saying. But I believe when we go against the devil, we need the Holy Spirit. I believe that we need to start speaking holiness on people. We need to start loosing the Holy Ghost up in the sanctuary. We need to go through our homes, and we need to loose the Holy Ghost in our homes. Now, I'm going to speak like a Pentecostal because that's what we are. That we don't call it the Holy Spirit. We call it the Holy Ghost up in here. And I believe, and that's a lot of the reason people don't exercise it, because they're scared of ghosts. I've been in Baptist churches. I announced my call to preach in a Baptist church. Never once have I heard a Baptist minister preach out of the book of Acts. And when they preach on the Holy Spirit. They don't preach on the Holy Ghost because most people are scared of ghosts. But I'm here to tell you, it ain't going to harm you. It ain't going to do nothing but help you. But I believe that we're in a war, church. I believe we're in a spiritual war that we need to hunker down. That we need to start loosing the Holy Spirit. Because that's who's going to win our battle, Sister Pat. That's who's going to win our battle, Sister Brandon. It's the Holy Spirit. It's not going to be one right here with these hands. It's not going to be one with this mind. It's going to be one in the Spirit. It's going to be one. But I'm here to tell you, they shouldn't even be at war because He's done give us the keys. He's done give us the keys of death, hell, and the grave. He's done win on the first day that was crucified and went to the grave. He done put the devil in his place. He come back and rose on the third day to set the church free.
Amen.
We bind ourselves most of the time. Church. Now, how many in here would lay their life down for one of these children?
Yeah.
How many would go through hell and back for one of these children?
Yeah.
to speak life over every one of these children.
Amen.
We have the power to speak life over one of these children. I believe that, and I think that we're in a time right now, such as now, that it's time we start equipping these children. Because they're going to battle against things that we ain't never seen. They're battling against things right now that we ain't never heard of. Let the teens come up just a moment. Jordan, I mean, don't know what's going through their mind. We have no clue of what they're battling with. Well, they just got a little homework on. They're overloaded with homework. Bless their hearts. And I'm as guilty as the rest. My mind come home overloaded with homework. And instead of praying for them and getting in a place of training on how to pray to God to help them, I just say, go do your homework. I'm guilty. I'm not preaching to the choir. I'm just as guilty to do the same thing. Instead of speaking life, instead of speaking Jesus, instead of speaking the power to bind this devil, that comes against our children, against our families. There's nothing no worse in my home than a kid to walk through and slam a door, because it'll probably get taken off the hinges. In our old house, there's no doors in the bedroom, because there's not even a door on my bedroom, because I can't stand a slamming door. But instead of letting them shut us out, church, reach in and open that door to life. Reach in and open that door that you can speak life to your children. They're not just children because you gave birth to them or you were a part of the conception of them, but they're yours because God has given them to you. God has set you in order to be parents. It's an honor. It's a blessing to be parents. There's still so many more in the back. But it's time that we equip our children. If you have your Bibles, turn with me to the book of Ephesians. Chapter 6. Y'all okay standing here? Y'all want to sit here. Jesus. And it says in chapter 6, starting with verse 10, it says, finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of His might. Now you can be the biggest man in the world. You can be the biggest bodybuilder in the world, but you have nothing if you don't have the Lord. I worked with a young man one time. He was a power lifter. He could squat 800 pounds. He could bench press about 500. Big old black guy. Big monstrous guy. And we worked together, but he was the weakest thing I've ever seen in my life when it comes to physically picking up something. He could lift all this weight, but he couldn't do something. That's the way we are as Christians. Without God, we have no strength. Without God, we have no power. Amen. And it says, put on the whole armor of God, that we may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. That's the reason we wear the armor, church. We don't wear the armor of God just because it looks good. We don't wear the armor of God just because it fits just right, because this tie is choking me this morning. We don't wear the armor of God just because I want to impress somebody. Because I'm here to tell you, if you do things for God because you want to be puffed up and be patted on the back, you're doing it for the wrong reasons.
Amen.
Well, preacher, that's easy for you to say. You're standing up there preaching in the light every Sunday morning. I'm doing what God called me to do.
Amen.
But I believe that we need to equip ourselves. And it says, put on the whole armor of God. Now you've heard me preach a little bit on the armor. Now, why are we going to go out with only half of it on in the morning, Brother Chris? It says, put on the whole armor. You know, I don't want, when we go to battle, when we go to combat, we go full battle rattle, don't we, Mark? You go on level 5, you take your gas gear, you take your hammer, you take your flat vest, you take it all with you because you're going into battle. He says, put on the whole armor of God. That way there's nowhere left open that the devil can come in. And it says, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness, of this wickedness in the heavenly places. We need to start making war in the heavens. We need to start crying out for our children. We need to be on our face crying out. I see people come to the altar, and a sign of true repentance, a sign of true prayer, is when they raise up off this altar and there's a wet spot because they cried out to Jesus. Or when you pray for them for something and a tear starts running down her face, that's when you know it's real. So many times we go to the altar and we get a temporary fix. It looked good that I went up and got prayed for this morning. It looked good to my wife that I got my stuff together. It looked good to my husband that I went up and I'm not going to be healed today. Well, bless God, it was faith. You need to put on something real, which is the full armor of God. You need to be equipped with it. You need to put it on in the morning. You need to, when you walk out the door, don't run back and say, I forgot that. I'll just put it on when I come home for lunch. Bless God, that leaves enough time for the devil to come in. And he may not come in on you, but he may come in on your children while you got your armor off. He may come in on your husband. He may come in on your wife. He may come in on whatever you dog. I don't know, but we need to be fully equipped with the armor of God. And it says, for we don't wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against darkness. Church, we're supposed to be the light of the world. You walk in a dark room, what's the first thing you do? You flip the light on. There's no more darkness. We need to start flipping the light on. We need to start walking with the light on, brother. We need to have a light on everywhere we go.
Amen.
Y'all heard me preach that being a witness and being a testimony, being a witness to somebody. We need to start being that light that we need to be. I'm sorry, Doug, I'm back and forth, bro. But we need to be that light that Christ is intended. We need to be able to shine light on the darkness. You need to be not afraid to call sin, sin. You need to be not afraid to call somebody wrong out. It's not judging when you're trying to help them. Now, if you go to them and say, brother, you're going to hell for doing that. And I ain't going to blame them when it pops you into mind. But I believe that we need to call sin, sin. We're equipped to do that. That's where, when we start letting one little thing in, that's when the rest of it comes in. When you're not fully equipped with the armor of God, that's when the other stuff comes flooding in. And it says, therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, stand. Having done all, stand. Because I'm here to tell you, when there's nothing else to do, you can stand. Because you can praise God, stand. Amen. You can pray to God, stand. You got the full armor on, so you're protected by God. And it says, standing therefore, having girded your waist with the truth. That's hard on people right there, the truth. People don't like the truth. The devil don't like the truth. He don't like knowing that he's done been defeated, church. That he's done lost the battle. That he can't drive a wedge in this church. Now we can disagree, we can complain, we can argue with each other, but I'm here to tell you the devil ain't going to drive a wedge in this church.
Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Amen. Come on.
You may not always like it, but the devil ain't driving a wedge in this church.
That's right.
And it says, standing therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Now, preacher, you said that's the gospel of peace, but you're telling us to war. We should always be looking for peace. We have peace in Jesus. We should always be looking for peace. But there's going to come a time we have to war. We're going to have to war. And it says, above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench the fiery darts of the wicked one. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Hallelujah. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. Now some of us may not be able to understand the Word like some of us, but I feel confident that you can understand enough that you can buy it. I feel like you can understand enough that you've heard enough in your life that you can read just enough. I know I got an uncle that's a preacher that can't read a lick. Can't read a lick. Don't even know how to sign his name. But he knows how to read the Word of God. He knows how to speak it because he's heard it long enough. But I believe that we need to be equipping ourselves. We need to, the Word of God is our life. That's how we speak life. I don't speak life into Brother Martin in the name of David Lineback. I don't speak life in Sister Martha in the name of David Lineback. There's something to do about Sister Martha. She got set free last Sunday. Some junk. But I believe that the sword of the Spirit, which is the Word of God. The Word of God is life, church. This is life. This is what we live by. Now, you can read every book ever wrote. You can read every book by D.L. Moody, Spurgeon. You can read every book by Rick Warren you want to read. You can read every book by Warren Wiersbe, whatever you want to do. But this is the Word of life.
That's right.
This is the Word of life. I don't care how they interpret it. This is the Word of life. And it says, praying always with all prayer. I don't think it says just praying every once in a while. It says praying always.
Yes.
I believe we should constantly have a praise upon our lips.
Amen.
I think we should praise God from the depths of our soul. I believe that, now I'm telling you that you can't stay in a prayer closet all the time. Because some of us has got to work. Some of us has got to go out. But I believe that you can continually be praying to God. I believe when you praise, it's prayer. It's lifted up. When you praise and you pray, it's lifted up to God. I believe that we need to continually be praising God and giving prayer. And it says, praying always with all prayer and supplication. Now here's the kicker right here, church. In the Spirit. In the Spirit. Now that's what I'm talking about right there. Now I'm not saying because you're not baptized in the Holy Ghost and don't speak in tongues that you don't pray in the Spirit. When you confess Christianity, the Holy Spirit come and live with you.
Right.
The Holy Spirit come and dwell in the temple. Now, your temple, you may still have things in your temple that the Holy Spirit's kicking out. So all of us should have things that we're working on. That's how we pray God in the Spirit. That's how we get in touch with God. As we start setting aside these half-hearted prayers of, now I'll lay me down to sleep, I pray the Lord my soul keeps. We start getting down to business with the Father. We start getting in a place of prayer that God knows we mean business. He knows when we call out to Jehovah, we need something from Jehovah. He knows when we call out Jehovah Jireh, He needs to provide something. When we call out Jehovah Rapha, He knows we need a healing in our body. When we call out Jehovah Shalom, He knows that we know that He's here with us. And it says with supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end, with all perseverance, supplication for the saints. And for me, the utterance may be given to me, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. I think some of us need to be like Apostle Paul. We need to. Apostle Paul was in a place he was bound in chains when he wrote this right here to the Ephesians. He was in a place where he was bound. And I believe that we need to take his Apostle Paul's advice. And we need to, and it says, and for me the utterance may be given to me. We need to pray that it's given to us, that we may open our mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel. And it's not a mystery, and it's not saying because it's an unsolved mystery. It's not saying it's one of Ariel, what's that Moody Blues mystery things that kids read or any of that thing. It's not that kind of mystery. It's the mystery that people don't know Jesus Christ.
Amen.
And it says, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in it I may speak boldly as I ought to speak. Church, we need a confidence about us. We need to know that when we go to war that we're equipped. When we go to battle that we're equipped. That we have the full armor of God. He's equipped us with everything we need. Because the church will always live on. The church will always stand because of the founder, the foundation, and the faithfulness of the church. Now there's going to be times you're going to see people steer away from God. They're going to lose faith. They're going to lose faithfulness in the church. But I'm going to tell you that the church will still be here. That the founder will still be here. The foundation will never be shaken. It'll never be broken. It'll never be crumbled away. That the foundation will always be here. It's time that we get equipped. It's time that we get in a place of war. That when we get up in the mornings, we're ready. We're ready to go into battle. When you kids walk out the door, I can vouch for this. Before my children get out of the car every morning, Brother Mark, my wife said, tell them what you say. Bless your children. Bless your children daily. That's how we war. As we put the hedge of protection about them. Now some of us need to hedge ourselves. can't go with Mark to work every day. But how we do it is we speak the name of Jesus on them. We speak life to them. We speak life because He's given us life as we stand to our feet. Musicians are coming. Praise you, Jesus. Every head bowed, every eye closed. No one looking around. If there be one in here today under the sound of my voice that doesn't know Jesus Christ as their Savior, that doesn't know about this life.